to the church. Let's just pause for a moment of prayer. Heavenly Father, we just thank you so very much for being with us
and being here this morning. I just pray, Lord, that you indeed would just bless this time as we lift up the name of Jesus. Lord, that you would bless each and every one that is involved and has engaging with us this morning, wherever they are, watching through Facebook Live. Father, we just give you the praise, we give you the honor. We do pray this in the name of Jesus. Amen. Hear the scriptures written this morning. Lord, my God, no one can compare to you. You have done many wonderful things. You have planned to do these things for us. There are too many of them for me to talk about. You didn't want sacrifices and offerings. You didn't require burnt offerings and sin offerings. You opened my ears so that I can hear you and obey you. Then I said, here I am. It is written about me in the book. My God, I have come to do what you want. Your law is in my heart. Psalm 45:8.
Good morning. Let's begin our worship today as we sing some songs of praise.
Worship the King.
just thank you so very much for your presence here with us this day. We know, Lord, that you are awesome. We know, Lord, that you are great. We know, Lord, that you alone are worthy of our praise and our worship and our adoration. And so, Lord, we have come to you this morning, and we have just lifted up our praise to you, and we continue, Lord, to lift up our praise. And Lord, I just pray that as we have gathered together this morning, wherever we are, that we would hear your word to us, your word of encouragement, your word of comfort, your word of challenge. So Lord, so that as we go through our day and as we go through our week, we will be encouraged and empowered with the power of the Holy Spirit. And God, we just have gathered for that purpose this morning. And we thank you. We thank you so very much for Jesus Christ. We thank you for his sacrifice upon the cross for our sins. We thank you that we can have faith. And that when we place our faith in him, we have forgiveness of our sins. And we have life. Life now and life ever after. So, Father God, we just ask your presence as we open your word and we study it together. And we do pray, Lord, that you would be with those everywhere that have been affected in one way or another through this COVID-19 that is going across our country and around the world. And I just pray, God, that you would just keep those that are in that are sick, that you would keep them protected. Lord, that you would allow the disease not to cause any complications. And Lord, I just pray that you'd be with those whom have already lost lives, and that you'd be with the survivors of those. And Lord, there will be others that are impacted. But Lord, just keep us strong. Keep us in prayer for these and others in our community. And Lord, I just pray that you would just be with us during these times, that things, that we would know that you are in control and that you are good all the time. Father, we give you the praise, we give you the glory, we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, this morning we have put together a service that is a little abbreviated from our regular service. And so I'm going to, at this time, invite you to turn with me in the scriptures. If you have your Bibles, turn with me to Psalm 23. Psalm 23. One moment while I get some PowerPoint slides up on the screen in front of you. Psalm 23, hoping you have found it either in your Bible or on a Bible app on your phone. And we are continuing in a series that is called Living Spaces. And this sermon series, Living Spaces, is all about opening up our lives for more of the Spirit of God to work in our lives. More of the Spirit of God for us to experience his work in our lives. And so we believe that there is space in our lives that we still can open up to him so that he can speak to us, and that so he can empower us, and so that we can have more of his life, more of his joy, more of his peace. The spiritual disciplines are what we are looking at as ways of opening up the space. We looked at celebration and worship. We looked at prayer. We looked at service. And we've looked at lament are all ways in which we can open up more of our life and more of the space in our lives for God to experience more of God. So this morning it's about restoring your soul. Restoring your soul to Scripture. As you, if you have it, Psalm 23, going to look especially at verses 1, 2, and 3 this morning. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He makes me lie down in pastures. He leads me beside the still waters. He restores my soul. Now that is reading out of the New King James Version. It's very similar to the one most of us learned as children in Sunday school. And that's the one that I wanted to read for you this morning. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside the still waters. He restores my soul. And there's our key verse. He restores my soul. A couple of years ago, maybe three now, we were running for our flight from Houston to DFW as we returned from Honduras. As we were literally running through the Houston airport, I had my backpack on my back. I had Selena's backpack on my front. I had two carry-on bags that I was dragging as we actually literally ran through the airport trying to make sure we made our flight. Didn't know if we were going to make it or not. The plane that we had been on had been one of those older planes, and so it didn't have the electrical outlets at all the seats. So my phone was just about out of battery. Now, my plan was to recharge my battery in my phone at the Houston airport, but we had no time for that to happen. Now, we did make our flight, but my phone was completely out of juice. It needed to be recharged. Now, I know there's been times in your life where your phone has gone all the way down to nothing and is needed to be recharged. And usually it's at a time that you're going, oh man, I can't believe that it needs to be recharged at this time. What I'm saying to you this morning is your spiritual life and your spiritual development is in need of being recharged on a regular basis as well. In your spiritual life and development, you must understand that you need to be recharged. And you are in charge of recharging your soul. So keep that very much in mind as we go forward. You are in charge of recharging your soul. Recharging is a matter of paying attention to your rhythm. Pay attention to your rhythm because every soul needs rhythm. Now, all of you know that I've got rhythm, right? I've got rhythm. No, maybe not. I know Alyssa, when she says, well, you really need to stop all those dance moves that you're trying. You just need to live right here. That's what Alyssa tells me. I just need to live right here. Well, that's because I do have, but you had better have, and I had better have, rhythm in our soul. Rhythm is created by leaving space between the notes and the beats of our life. There was a famous French composer of the 20th century known, his name was Claude Debussy. And Claude Debussy said this, music is the space between the notes. You see, we often do not leave enough space between the notes in our lives. We are not creating enough living spaces where God can fill us with his spirit. You see, God loves rhythm. God wove rhythm into creation. The sun rises and the sun sets. It's light and then it's dark. Every month we have a full moon, and every month we have a new moon, which is really no moon, but we have this cycle, and we have this rhythm, and we have seasons. And every year we go through the certain seasons of spring and summer and fall and winter, spring, summer, fall, winter. We have a rhythm. God put these rhythms into our creation. He also put rhythm into our bodies. Well, I have a heart right now that's beating, and then it rests. It beats and it rests. We have lungs that fill up with air and lungs that breathe air out. We breathe in, we breathe out. There's a rhythm in our bodies. Our bodies are active through the day, and we sleep at night. There's another rhythm. Awake during the day, sleep at night. Awake, sleep. And we need these rhythms. God loves these rhythms in our bodies and in our spirit and in our soul as well. We need spiritually space between the notes. We need spiritually times to be recharged. King David lived this. And he writes about this rhythm. He writes about his need to be recharged. In one of the most famous chapters in our Bible, Psalm 23, that we read the first three verses of this morning, David writes, "The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want." Another translation says, "The Lord is my shepherd, I lack nothing." Another translation says, "The Lord is my shepherd, I have all that I need."
With the Lord is our shepherd,
we don't have any needs. We don't have any wants. They're taken care of with the Lord as my shepherd. That's what he's saying. And he says, "He makes me to lie down in green pastures." Another translation says, "He lets me rest in green meadows." And then he says, "He leads me beside quiet waters, still waters, beside peaceful streams," yet another translation says.
"He restores my soul."
One translation says, "He refreshes my soul." Yet another one says, "He renews my strength." Now understand, David was a man of action. He was a man of power. Whether he was guarding his sheep, whether he was killing bears, whether he was up against a giant, whether he was leading as the general of the army of Israel, whether he was governing the nation of Israel, David was one busy man. And he knew his soul could become depleted. And so he wrote into his life this rhythm. David meditated on God's word. He sat in silence in nature. He strummed his harp in private. He wrote worship songs. He journaled, writing down his feelings. He prayed alone in the temple. He danced before the Lord. Why did he do all this? Because David understood how to recharge his soul.
Many scholars believe that
David wrote Psalm 23 not when he was a young shepherd boy, but much later in life, recalling the life of the shepherd, and when he understood the rhythm of life that he needed to recharge his soul. It was focused time alone to lie down in green pastures, to stop and to rest. It was focused time alone beside the still waters in the quiet place.
Can I ask you, where is your
quiet place with Jesus?
Where is your
green pasture? Where is your quiet waters? We all need them. We all need times of recharging our soul, restoring our soul. Jesus lived this rhythm. In Mark 1:35, we read, "Very early in the morning, while it was still dark, Jesus got up, left the house, and went off to a solitary place where he prayed." Now, in the previous verses to that verse, it says, in beginning in verse 33, "The whole town gathered at his door, and Jesus healed many who had various diseases. He also drove out many demons, but he would not let the demons speak." And then it goes on and on. And I can imagine the people were still standing at the door when he called it a night. And I can imagine they were there the next morning waiting when he was ready to start. So that's why the scripture says, "Very early in the morning while it was still dark, Jesus got up, left the house, went to a solitary place where he prayed."
We see a different incident,
but the same kind of truth in Luke chapter 5, where it says, "Yet the news of him spread all the more, so the crowds of people came to hear him and to be healed of their sicknesses. But Jesus often withdrew to lonely places and prayed." Do you hear that? "But Jesus often withdrew to lonely places to pray." You see, we have this idea that if there's people in front of us and people have a need, or there's things to be done and tasks to be done, then we just got to keep going. We just got to keep moving. We got to keep ministering and keep working until we drop. But that's not what Jesus did.
Jesus was always doing great
acts of love. He was meeting the needs of people physically and emotionally and spiritually, but he often left the crowd with their needs standing there.
He would turn away. He would turn around
and walk away. That doesn't sound much like a very nice thing to do, right? But Jesus understood something. He understood the space between the notes.
He lived this rhythm, and he understood if he was going to have the energy and then to recharge his soul so that he could continue to meet the needs of the people, that he had to be recharged. He would be with God, and then he would be with people. He would be with God and people, and then he would be with God and alone. He would be with God and people, then he would be with God and alone. You see the rhythm? Rinse, repeat, rinse, repeat. And here's the deal. When we miss the rhythm, we start to lose the music of our lives. I watch so many lives run out of music because they don't understand the rhythm of their life. Jesus trains his disciples this rhythm. In Mark chapter 6, it says that there were so many people coming and going that the disciples did not even have a chance to eat. Jesus said to them, "Come with me by yourselves to a quiet place and get some rest." So they went away with him in a boat to a solitary place. Hear what's going on? The disciples were busy. They were so very busy that they didn't even have time to stop for lunch. They couldn't even send someone out on a Chick-fil-A run. They were so very busy with ministry. And then Jesus, knowing their busyness, says, "Okay, let's go, boys. It's time to pull away. It's time to recharge. It's time to go to that solitary place so that you know, he didn't say, just keep praying and keep on going, boys. Just hang in there. He didn't say this kind of things. He didn't say, just remember, you're doing this for Jesus. It's okay to burn out for him. No, he didn't say that kind of thing.
What Jesus was telling them
is stop serving the people for a while so you can recharge, so that you can keep serving the people longer. I don't know about you, but I need to rest more. But I also know that I'm not too busy to take time to Sabbath, to rest. Taking time to Sabbath is a command. The Lord said we need Sabbath. We need to find time to rest. And I know during this time when many of you feel like you're sequestered in your own homes and you're not able to get out and to go to restaurants or to other events that you want to get to, you feel like, well, I'm resting all the time this past week or so, and I've got more coming. But are you really resting?
This is a time to really
have that opportunity to rest, to recharge your soul, to recharge and to commit yourself to being more about what God has for you to be. So oftentimes, we attempt to do self-care,
and oftentimes,
we don't do it right. We think that we're doing something good for ourselves, but oftentimes, it's selfish care and not self-care. You say, well, what's the difference? Well, selfish care is doing the things that resemble self-care, but are really just imitations of what our soul really desires. It's almost like when you get hungry, what do? Well, if you're on the go, you usually will just grab anything that you can find, a snack, or you'll go through a drive-thru and get fast food, and if you're in an office, if there's any candy, I fell into that this week. Working at my desk here at the church is within an arm's reach of the candies that Talina has to give out on Family Worship Sunday after people have turned in their sermon notes. Well, I thought I was hungry, so I looked up and there's a box of Reese's Pieces. And it wasn't long until I had those opened. And I thought, you know, I'm just going to eat just a couple now and a little bit, eat a couple more. But before I knew it, they were all gone. That's what we do when we're hungry, right? We snack, or we go through these fast food places. It's quick, it's easy, it's convenient. It might even taste good, but is it really the best thing for us? Yeah, I could have done without the Reese's Pieces. Yeah, I could do without a lot of things that I have in my life that I think are good for me, but aren't necessarily all that good. Sometimes that is the selfish care. Selfish care is often in the form of distractions. In this day and age, we're really good at being distracted.
distracted, right? We do all kinds of things to find things to numb our pain. We do all kinds of things to we engage in all kinds of entertainment. In fact, just this morning, I know many of you are looking at your iPhones right now, and thank you for doing that. But this morning, I had that little notice that comes up as to how often I was on, how much screen time I had this week, and it said my screen time had increased this week. Well, that makes sense because I've been looking at different things, trying to see how to transition the church into more of social media kind of thing. But it said I was averaging almost 5 hours a day in screen time. I'm going, whoa, 5 hours a day? And then I look around at others and I'm thinking, I bet others have way more screen time than that. Not saying it's all bad. But I'm saying that it can be a distraction, and that's just one of many things that can distract us and make us think that we're in this taking care of ourselves when it's really not good self-care. See, we binge watch, we binge eat, we binge shop, we binge game, and we have all these really unhealthy addictions to these kind of things, not to mention the things that we know are wrong for us. Where's the self-care? Good self-care is tending to and respecting the limits and the needs that God has designed for us. God has designed us to rest. God has designed for us to recharge in His Word, by reading His Word, by meditating on His Word. Meditating on His Word. Joshua 1:8. Says this, keep the book of the law always on your lips, meditate on it day and night, so that you may be careful to do everything written in it. In other words, how are we going to know what God is asking for us to do, desiring us to do, how He desires us as His children to live our lives? How are we going to do that unless we read it, His Word? Meditate on His Word. And then the promise comes at the end of that verse, Joshua 1:8. Then you will be prosperous and successful. Then you will have your soul recharged and ready to follow through with what God has for your life. Let me just close with this verse from Matthew 11:28-30. Jesus talking here, and He says, Matthew 11:28, come to me, all of you who are weary and burdened, and I will give you rest. Can I take a little bit of liberty and say, come to me, all you who are where your batteries are running low and your energy is running down, and I will recharge your soul. It goes on to say, take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and humble and of heart, and you will find rest for your souls. You will find recharge for your souls in me. Some of us are tired. We're really tired. Some of us are really stressed. Some of us are under such a heavy burden. Some of us are going way too fast. Jesus said, I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and humble in heart, and you will find rest for your souls. What are you doing to recharge your soul? What are you doing? Jesus says, come to me. Jesus says, all the recharge you need, and you know, He said to do it on a daily basis too. If anyone would follow me, you need to take up your cross daily and follow me. Daily. Now, it's like our phones, we have to recharge them daily. Some of us have to recharge them more than once a day. So it is with our souls. They need to be recharged with the Spirit of God so that we can truly, earnestly follow in the footsteps of Jesus. As I get ready to close this morning, I don't know what's going on in your life. I know that you're probably in a place where it's calm and quiet, maybe less kids are running around and trying to run out their energy. But I do know that we all can quiet our hearts before the Lord, and that we all need to be recharged. And this is one of the ways in which we can find space in our lives for God to fill us with more of His life and more of His power. So let us rest in Jesus this morning. Let's pray. Father God, I just pray that you would be with each and every one, each and every one that is watching this morning. And Lord, if they have allowed their soul to be discharged, that Lord, that they would call upon you, and that they would seek your face, that they might be recharged. And Lord, if there are any watching this morning that are in need of a relationship with Jesus in the first place, I just pray, Lord, that they would open up their heart and admit to you, God, that they have been trying to do it on their own and they need help, and that they would commit their lives to Jesus. And I just pray that anybody and everybody that is watching this morning, that you can do this right now. Just simply say, God, I'm sorry for sinning against you. I'm sorry for trying to live my life my way. I commit to following Jesus Christ as my Savior and as my Lord. I ask Him to forgive me of my sins, that I might have life and that I might begin it now. And if you would just pray that simple prayer, Jesus will come into your life, and your life can begin to be charged by the Spirit of God. Now, maybe there are some that are watching that need to recommit their life, to recommit to recharging on a daily basis so that your soul can be restored. And I just pray right now for you, God. I just pray that you'd be with those that are in need of a recommitment, that you would just be with them in a mighty with a very tender hand, reach out to them and let them know that they are loved and that they can be recharged daily so that they might have your love and peace in a great and mighty way. Now, Lord, I just pray as we close our time this morning that we will not stop our time of worship, that it will continue on into the rest of the day and on into the week to come, and that you will bring us back together next week ready to hear more of how to have more space in our lives for Jesus
and for the Holy Spirit to work. We pray this in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord
and our Savior. Amen.
And amen. Thank you so much for watching.
We will see you again.
Facebook Live.